Some words from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 5. God says, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. Well, let's sing to the one and only God, our God, in hymn number 248, number 248 in our blue hymn books, Immortal, Invisible, God only wise, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes. Number 248. Well, let us bow our heads for some moments of prayer. We turn in our hearts trustingly to the immortal, invisible, wonderful, true God, who has revealed himself to us uniquely in the person of his Son. He who has seen me has seen the Father, says Jesus. So our gracious Father, we do come to you. You are hidden from our sight. The splendor of heaven is your domain. And we look forward to seeing you in the end with our own eyes because of what Christ has done to remove the barrier of our sin and rebellion, our separation from you. But now, dear Father, we cannot see you, but we turn our hearts to you in love and trust. We thank you for the commands of the Apostle Paul, that if indeed we've been raised with Christ, we're to seek the things that are above, where Christ is, and to set our minds on things there, not on things that are on earth. For, says Paul, you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you: sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. On account of these, the wrath of God is coming. So, our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for Paul, the Apostle, and his instructions, and we pray indeed that you will teach us, as our life develops and goes on, to learn how to set our minds upon the things that are above more and more, rather than on the things that are on earth, the things that are transient, the things that are not worth holding on to. Help us to dwell increasingly in heart and mind in the heavenly places with you, because in a very real sense we have died, and our life is already hidden with Christ and with you. And therefore we pray that you will help us to put to death all the things that the Apostle mentions, that you'll help us to turn with hatred towards sinful things, sinful attitudes and practices, that you'll help us to love the things that you love, compassion and kindness, the teaching and spreading of the gospel, the fellowship of the church, the enjoyment of studying and sharing and reading your words together. We pray that you'll fill our hearts more and more with love for you and the love that demonstrates itself in obedience to your wonderful commands. We dare to ask, dear Father, that the thrust, the substance of the Ten Commandments will be ever more deeply written in our hearts, so that it is not a painful or difficult thing to obey them, but something that we learn to love to do more and more, because it brings honor to your name that we should live like that. So, dear Father, have mercy upon us and continue to change our hearts. Continue to be at work in us, subduing the things that are wrong and helping us to love what is right and noble and true and good and worthy of praise. And we do ask that as we spend this time here this morning, you will fill us afresh with your words and truth, and that you will help us to understand your way more deeply and to love it. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, let's look up there. Time for one or two notices. I think you should have received the famous yellow leaflet, which we distribute every week. Do pick up a copy of that. I think there's only one thing particularly to mention, and that is on the right hand, if you look at the inside of the leaflet, about halfway down on the right hand side, church family congregational meeting. Now, that's a very important time for us to get together, a week on Wednesday, which is the 1st of March, 7:30 in the evening at Kelvin Grove, which is our chance to look back and look forward, our annual meeting at this time of the year. So do, if you possibly can, come to that. As for other things, well, do take this home. Use it for your prayers and your information. I think everything that's going on is included there this week. And if you're new here, do make yourself known to us afterwards. We'd like to shake a hand, tell you a bit more about what's going on, and personally welcome you. Good. Well, let's turn now for our Bible reading to Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 44. Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 44. And we're reading down to the end of chapter 5. Now you'll see partway through chapter 5, we have the Ten Commandments, but they're described as the Ten Words. So do bear that in mind. These Ten Commandments are known as the Ten Words. So chapter 4 and verse 44. This is the law that Moses set before the people of Israel. These are the testimonies, the statutes, and the rules which Moses spoke to the people of Israel when they came out of Egypt, beyond the Jordan, in the valley opposite Beth Peor, in the land of Sihon, the king of the Amorites who lived at Heshbon, whom Moses and the people of Israel defeated when they came out of Egypt. And they took possession of his land and the land of Og, the king of Bashan, the two kings of the Amorites who lived to the east beyond the Jordan, from Aroer, which is on the edge of the valley of the Arnon, as far as Mount Sirion, that is Hermon, together with all the Arabah on the east side of the Jordan, as far as the Sea of the Arabah, under the slopes of Pisgah. And Moses summoned all Israel and said to them, "Hear, O Israel, the statutes and rules that I'm speaking in your hearing today. And you shall learn them and be careful to do them. The Lord our God made a covenant with us in Horeb. Not with our fathers did the Lord make this covenant, but with us, with all of us here alive today. The Lord spoke with you face to face at the mountain, out of the midst of the fire, while I stood between the Lord and you at that time, to declare to you the word of the Lord. For you were afraid because of the fire, and you did not go up into the mountain." He said, "I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image, or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Observe the Sabbath day to keep it holy, as the Lord your God commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, or your male servant or your female servant, or your ox or your donkey, or any of your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates, that your male servant and your female servant may rest as well as you. You shall remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God brought you out from there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God commanded you to keep the Sabbath day. Honor your father and your mother, as the Lord your God commanded you, that your days may be long and that it may go well with you in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder, and you shall not commit adultery, and you shall not steal, and you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor, and you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, and you shall not desire your neighbor's house, his field, or his male servant or his female servant, his ox or his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. These words the Lord spoke to all your assembly at the mountain, out of the midst of the fire, the cloud, and the thick darkness, with a loud voice. And he added no more. And he wrote them on 2 tablets of stone and gave them to me. And as soon as you heard the voice out of the midst of the darkness, while the mountain was burning with fire, you came near to me, all the heads of your tribes and your elders, and you said, "Behold, the Lord our God has shown us his glory and greatness, and we have heard his voice out of the midst of the fire. This day we have seen God speak with man, and man still live. Now therefore, why should we die? For this great fire will consume us. If we hear the voice of the Lord our God any more, we shall die. For who is there of all flesh that has heard the voice of the living God speaking out of the midst of fire as we have, and has still lived? Go near and hear all that the Lord our God will say and speak to us, all that the Lord our God will speak to you, and we will hear and do it. And the Lord heard your words when you spoke to me. And the Lord said to me, I have heard the words of this people which they have spoken to you. They are right in all that they have spoken. Oh, that they had such a mind as this always, to fear me and to keep all my commandments, that it might go well with them and with their descendants forever. Go and say to them, return to your tents. But you, stand here by me, and I will tell you the whole commandment and the statutes and the rules that you shall teach them, that they may do them in the land that I am giving them to possess. You shall be careful, therefore, to do as the Lord your God has commanded you. You shall not turn aside to the right hand or to the left. You shall walk in all the way that the Lord your God has commanded you, that you may live, and that it may go well with you, and that you may live long in the land that you shall possess. Amen. The words of the Lord, and may they be a blessing to us today. And now, friends, we're going to sing again. Are we in good voice? Let's have a little cough, clear our throats, and we'll turn to hymn number 558, number 558. O God, who shaped the starry skies and made the sun in splendor rise, whose love our life imparts, still may that same creative word, this is about the words of God, which formless void and darkness heard, be known within our hearts. A prayer that the word of God will rest and remain within us. Number 558. Now we have a few moments of pause while our offering for the Lord's work here and further afield will be taken up. The musicians will play for us, and then we shall have a further time of prayer together. Let us pray. The prophet Amos, or the Lord speaking through him, says this: "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine of bread or a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea and from north to east. They shall run to and fro to seek the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it." Dear God, our Father, we take to heart from these words of the prophet that to live upon your words is the most delightful and wonderful thing, not only for the individual or for the congregation, but for a whole nation. And we think, dear Father, that if our nation were willing to live by your words, willing to live by the Ten Commandments, what a blessing and what a transformation of society we would see. The police, perhaps, could then go home, and the judicial system could be dismantled because there would be no crime. And to think of people being able to live together in love and deep trust in one another would be a wonderful thing, without covetousness, without suspicion and envy. But we know, dear Father, that it's not like that this side of heaven, and therefore we do pray that you will enable our nation to develop a fresh hunger for the words of the Lord. We think of this terrible prophecy from Amos, the idea that people might seek the word of the Lord, might go to and fro, travel for miles, and yet not be able to find it. And our prayer is that in our nation, this may be less and less so, that people will be able to move around and find the word of the Lord, find not only the Bible, but congregations where the word of the Lord is honored and loved. So we pray, dear Father, for the churches across our country, that you will enable our congregations to be unashamed of the Bible and its teaching in this day and age when the Bible is so much under attack. We pray that where the ethical standards of the gospel again are despised and turned away from, even in church congregations, you might in your mercy look down upon the churches again to change hearts and to help us to turn to your words, even if it's costly to us, even if it's in the face of difficulty and persecution within our nation. We pray, therefore, for all in the churches who have responsibility for teaching your word. We think of ministers and other leaders, not least those who teach our young people. And we pray that you will give to all who teach your word a growing confidence in its truth and trustworthiness. We pray for the hearts of our young people, not least in our own church, that you will open their hearts to love your word and to determine, even as youngsters, to stand by it and to be unashamed of it as they grow up into adult responsibility. So, dear Father, please write deep in our hearts once again the conviction that man cannot live by bread alone, but rather by every word that comes from your mouth. And we pray that our hearts this morning, as we hear your word opened up again from Deuteronomy, will not be hard-hearted towards you, but will be tender and ready to receive and to obey with joy. So please have mercy upon us, and we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, now we're going to sing together again, and I think this one's on the screens. "Now in reverence and awe we gather round your word, in wonder we draw near." Let's sing together. Thank you.
Turn with me, if you would, in your Bibles to Deuteronomy chapter 5, page 150. In the church Bibles, a chapter which is all about walking in the truth, which is the foundation of all real faith. Let me start with a question. What does it mean to really have faith? People are often confused in their ideas about that, but it's absolutely vital to understand that according to Jesus Christ, faith is not just some sort of natural character trait that some people have and some people don't have. No, for Jesus, indeed for the whole Bible, faith means a decisive response to the command and call of God. It's a personal response to the personal revelation of God from God himself. That's why faith and obedience are used all the way through the Bible almost interchangeably. In fact, Paul calls it, doesn't he, the obedience of faith. Because all true faith in God means obedient submission to God. And all true submission to God is the expression of real faith and trust in God. The call of God's eternal kingdom is a call to repentance, that's clear, to a turning away from the path of this world, from our own way of self-rule, and towards, again, God's way, and to walk under God's sovereign rule. That's what it is. That's why Jesus' call to his kingdom is a call to follow me, to follow the sovereign God revealed at last in the flesh. So at the beginning of Matthew's gospel, Jesus begins his ministry like that. The kingdom of God is at hand, therefore repent and follow me. What does that mean to repent and follow Jesus? Well, Jesus goes on immediately to teach, doesn't he? Exactly what that means, proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom all throughout Galilee. And that gospel, of course, that he taught is summarized for us in Matthew 5-7, what we call the Sermon on the Mount. And of course, it's a call, isn't it, to absolute surrender. It's a call to surrender to Jesus, the sovereign Lord, the King. To hear the word of God and obey the Father in heaven, says Jesus. To hear my words and do them is what makes you wise for salvation. It's what it means to follow Jesus in faith in the way of his heavenly kingdom. And absolute surrender to the sovereign means, according to Jesus, absolute sacrifice of ourself. Whoever does not take up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. It's whoever who loses his life for my sake, in that kind of glad surrender, whoever loses his life will find it. Find true life in all its fullness that Jesus came to bring. For to surrender to the true sovereign is to find liberating release in life, because he's our loving Redeemer. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, my burden is light. And that's the way it's always been from the very beginning of God's dealings in grace with his people, the people he's called to himself to be his own. To hear and to heed the command of the sovereign Lord is to answer the call of the saving Lord, the Lord whose service is perfect freedom. God's call is an amazing liberation. And yet it is also a call always to absolute loyalty. And so J.I. Packer is absolutely right when he defines biblical faith this way. It is credence plus commitment. It's assurance plus allegiance. It's devotion plus discipleship. Or as the Apostle John puts it in his third letter, it is walking in the truth. And here's a chapter written for us, as the apostles remind us, where we see so very clearly in God's call to Israel right back at the very beginning, where we see what the foundations of such real biblical faith really are, what it means to respond truly to the God who reveals himself as both Savior and Sovereign, as both Redeemer and Ruler. Walking in his truth is the only way to life and blessing and fullness. Look at verse 33. You shall walk in all the way the Lord your God has commanded you, that you may live, that it may go well with you, and that you may live long in the land that you shall possess. Walking in the truth is the way of life. Now, we're not going to examine today the Ten Commandments in great detail, because that's precisely what Moses does in the next 20 chapters of Deuteronomy, and we will see that as we go along. But what I want us to see today is the impact of this chapter as a whole, as it tells us that following the Redeemer in faith really means walking in his ways, walking in his truth really means hearing his voice and heeding his words, and going on, being humbled in his presence. Look first at chapter 4, verse 44, down to the fifth verse of chapter 5, which are all about hearing the abiding voice of our Redeemer. And the focus here is on the nature of this great revelation that took place at Sinai, at Horeb, as Deuteronomy calls it. And the last paragraph there of chapter 4 recaps the history that we've already seen in much more detail in chapters 1 to 3 to ram home the point that Moses' words are not just of mere academic interest, but rather they press home a sense of destiny and a sense of decision. These people are the people who have been rescued out of Egypt. Notice the repetition of that in verse 45 and again verse 46. Out of Egypt, but now at last on the brink of a new future. In other words, this is a new start for a new generation. And this was to be their Sinai experience. And as the people responded back then at Sinai, so must they respond. But they must go on responding, not turning back. It's a moment of destiny for them. And so it's a moment of great decision, because they stand on the brink of the land. And again, this is to be their Kadesh Barnea moment, when previously the people stood on the brink of the land. But unlike them, they are not to fail, not to turn aside to the right or to the left, but to go on following God wholeheartedly. And you see, friends, when God in his mercy gives us a second chance in life, because sin and disobedience has perhaps left us in a mess, left us in the wilderness for many times. When God in his mercy gives us a second chance, we're not to blow it. We're to listen and to follow him. He is gracious, but we must never meet God's grace with an attitude of presumption, but with penitence and with a renewed obedience to his gracious call. And every day of our life is a new today as we journey through our life with God, isn't it? An obedient faith always begins with hearing his voice afresh today, this day. And that's the first word of Moses in verse 1 of chapter 5. Do you see? Hear, O Israel, the statutes and the rules that I speak in your hearing today, and you shall know them and be careful to do them. Actually, if you look down to chapter 6, verse 3, you'll see that this introduction to Moses' great speech really ends there, and it's bracketed in the same way, isn't it? Hear, O Israel, today, and be careful to do them so that it may go well with you. It's our response to hearing the voice of God the Redeemer that is the foundation of all real faith. Because our God is above all the speaking God. We saw that last time, repeatedly in chapter 4, but it's foundational, isn't it? Right from the very beginning of the Bible. Page 1 of your Bible, God speaks the creation into being, and God said, and it was. And the whole creation responds to honor God's voice. All was very, very good. And God goes on speaking. He speaks covenant relationship into being with his people. His call of grace elicits that response of faith in Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all down. And notice here two things about the word that he speaks to his people. First of all, it's a perennial word. It's ceaseless. It's permanent. It's imperishable. It's a living and abiding word, as the Apostle Peter calls it. The Lord who spoke first at Horeb in verse 2, back at Sinai, he speaks to this new generation today through those very same words, which are living and abiding words. Look at verse 3. So much so, you see, that Moses can say, not with our fathers did the Lord make his covenant, but with us, with all of us who are alive today. The Lord spoke with you at the mountain. He doesn't mean, of course, he didn't speak to their fathers who were at the mountain. It's an expression. He means he didn't speak only with them, though, but he was speaking and is speaking with you also today. It emphasizes that God's word is never, ever a thing of the past. Because he is the living God, his word is a living word. Once it's spoken, it goes on speaking. It goes on speaking in the same powerful way to future generations. And future generations can't fail to relate to it, either in obedience or in disobedience, and therefore either for weal or for woe. Look at verses 9 and 10, do you see? Visiting iniquity to the third and fourth generation of an entire family, as a typical Israelite family would live, three or four generations together, if the father spurns God's words. That's an important warning to those of us who are fathers. And yet, showing abundant love to the thousandth generation of those who do love and obey his word. God's word abides because God's covenant abides, and his words are covenant words. It's a creative word. It creates real and living relationship with his people. Now, those of you students of language and linguistics, you'll know all about speech acts. It's just a way of saying that words actually do things. They have a force to create, to change, and to go on doing so. Yesterday, at Kelvin Grove building, Innes and Megan stood before us and performed very profound speech acts. They said, "I will," in the answer to the question, "Will you have this man and will you have this woman to be your wedded wife?" And those words established a marriage. But not just for yesterday. They don't need to wake up today and say all those words again to each other and do it again tomorrow and so on. No. Those words are living and abiding words. They pledge fidelity one to another, and they go on doing so, so that in 20 years' time, the one can say to the other, "It wasn't just 20 years ago that we spoke those words to each other. It's today and every day that those words go on having their binding force, because that is a powerful covenant word." And you see, God's words are similarly perennial words and therefore powerful words. Once his word is uttered, it goes on speaking the same word, the same command, the same call down the generations. And that's why also we see so clearly here, secondly, that God's word is a personal word. A personal word to each new generation. Verse 4, the Lord spoke with you face to face. It's a personal word for you in this generation, he's saying. It's to you, verse 5, that he's speaking everything that now follows, to you, face to face, because his word is perennial, it's living and abiding, and therefore it can be personal to every new generation, as long as it's called today. And that's why centuries later, the Apostle Peter can quote from the Old Testament scriptures, from the book of Isaiah, and say, "The word of the Lord remains forever." And he says to his own readers, "And this word is the good news that was preached to you and through which you have been born again, through the imperishable word, the imperishable seed of the living and abiding word of God." And do you see how important it is to grasp that? Because that means that wherever the Bible is opened and God's words are spoken afresh, even if they are ancient words like these ones, then God is speaking today a personal word face to face with you and me. God's word brings us face to face with the Redeemer in a deeply personal encounter with him. We're not just hearing about God when his word is open. We are hearing him face to face. And that means, of course, that if you long for your friends, for your loved ones to meet God, to encounter the living God, then you know what to do, don't you? Bring them to hear the abiding voice of the Redeemer. Open the Bible with them. Let God's word speak. And he speaks to them face to face. Above all, bring them to a gathering of the church where God's word is spoken from the scriptures. And as Paul says to the church in Corinth, do you remember, even the most unlearned, even the most ignorant will be convicted, will be conscious of the presence of the living God here among them. And they will say, surely God is among this people. They encounter him face to face. We meet him in his word, as we sang. See, this generation of Israel didn't have to go back to have a repeat Sinai experience. Its power lived on in that personal, powerful word of God. And nor do we today need to go back and have a repeat Pentecost experience in order to have an encounter, an intimate encounter with the living God. No. The Spirit, once for all delivered, goes on bringing us face to face with the living God through his living and abiding word that we have in the scriptures. And real faith begins, for every single generation, begins with hearing the abiding voice of the Redeemer. How are they to believe, says Paul to the Romans, in one whom they have never heard? Faith, he says, comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ, the living and abiding covenant word of God. But of course, Paul goes on there, doesn't he, to say that not all obeyed the gospel. There is a kind of hearing that merely deceives ourselves, as the Apostle James reminds us. When we hear, he says, we need to receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. That is what he says, is true hearers of the word will be doers of the word, as Jesus himself constantly taught. Don't call me Lord and not do what I tell you. My true mother and brothers, my true family are those who hear the word of God and do it. And that's exactly what Moses makes utterly plain to us here, doesn't he, in verses 6 to 22. He makes absolutely clear that following the Redeemer in faith means heeding the authoritative words of the Redeemer. And the focus here is on the character and the substance of the revelation at Sinai, which is all about how to walk in the way of the Lord, which is, notice again, look at verse 33, the way of the Lord is the way of life. It's the way of blessing. It's the way of fruitfulness, not a way of legalistic bondage. Chapter 6, verse 2, do them that your days may be long. Verse 3, that it may go well with you in the land full of abundance, milk and honey. God's commands are a blessing of his grace, and they show his people the way of gracious blessing. The Lord is the shepherd who restores his people, who leads them in right paths, paths of goodness, paths of mercy, not paths of harm. And the good shepherd, says Jesus, calls his sheep by name and leads them. And they follow him. Why? Because Jesus says, I'm the good shepherd who came to bring you life, life in all its abundant fullness. And these 10 words, as they're called here, not laws, notice verse 22, but these words, these are God's words to guide us in life, in the realm of God's grace. First, notice that they come, don't they, in the context of grace, verse 6. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. He is their redeemer, he's their rescuer first, before he even talks about being their ruler. That's so important to grasp. God's deeds for us precede his demands from us, always. And God's Torah, his instruction, his law, is about expressing our life within his covenant of grace and mercy and liberating redemption. It's not about how to get into his salvation, not at all. It's about how to love the God who has first loved us with his abundance and his mercy. It's after he has promised, I will take this woman to be my wedded wife, to have and to hold, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness, in health, to love and to cherish, till death us do part. After that is promised, that the bride therefore answers, therefore with my body I thee honor, with all my worldly goods I thee endow. It's an expression of utter loyalty and fidelity and love in response to what has already been promised and offered. And that is what the Lord asks of his people here in this covenant call. It's not so much for them to do something, but for them to be something. He is saying, be mine. Be mine alone. Give me your heart and me alone. Look down to chapter 6, verse 5. That's what he's saying there. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. And that's what God's law is and does. It teaches us what it means to be his and only his. To be the loyal lover of one Lord, having no rivals. It's no more legalistic than Jesus saying to his disciples, whoever has my commandments and keeps them loves me. And whoever loves me will keep my words. It's just exactly the same. So never miss the context of grace here. Yes, God's grace always demands great response. But God's grace evokes response. We can only live as God's people if God has made us his people. But second, notice the clarity also of his grace expressed in these commands. Verse 22, these words the Lord spoke to all your assembly, and he wrote them, and he gave them to me. See, God's words are clear, public truth. They're available to all to know and to understand and therefore to obey. Unlike the pagans could never know if what they were really doing pleased their gods. They lived in ignorance and fear. No. God's people know exactly where they stand with their God. Remember first century Athens, that place full of great wisdom and philosophy. And when Paul went there, what did he find among all those magnificent buildings? An altar to the unknown God. Lest in all their worship and all their religion, they might be a God that they had missed with laws that they didn't know. And just in case, they better offer these other sacrifices. That is the dark night of paganism. But we can know exactly God's will for our lives, what it really is, about everything that matters. There's great grace in the clarity of God's law. We have it with absolute clarity and absolute authority, what God has spoken and written and given to us. So this is not the realm of debatable advice. This is the realm of absolute divine authority. And how much more so is that true for us who live in these latter days that Moses could only look towards from the distance, where we have not only the words of Moses and the prophets, but also the words spoken ultimately in the person of Jesus Christ. The world became flesh. We can know with absolute clarity exactly what God's will for our lives is. And what Moses shows us here and what Jesus and the apostles show us in the New Testament is that God's great concern, his real will for our lives, is not focused on material issues, but on moral issues. Divine guidance for life is not a thing that can be found in horoscopes. It's found in holiness. Isn't that the exact reverse of the way that most people think in the world today? They want guidance, knowledge about what to do, where to live, who to marry, what to buy. Even Christians, when we talk about guidance so often, are nearly always focused on guidance about our circumstances. But God's will always focuses on godliness in our characters. Whenever anybody asks me about guidance or is confused about guidance, I open up Paul's letter to the Thessalonians in chapter 4 and 5. This is the will of God, says Paul, your holiness, that you flee sexual immorality, that you love one another, and that you live and work worthily before outsiders. For God has not called us for iniquity, but for holiness. So you can be a fireman or a physicist. You can be a teacher or a trumpeter. You can be married or single. You can live in Scotland or Singapore. God doesn't mind anything about that. He hasn't given us his preferences. What he has said is, whatever you do, do all for the glory of God. Because through Jesus Christ, our great Redeemer, we belong to him. And that's God's will for our lives. Lives that he has redeemed by his grace. And that is exactly what the Decalogue here expresses so clearly. So notice, thirdly, the claim of grace that is expressed in these commands. Quite simply, God claims the whole of our lives. He claims our worship, the whole of the love of our heart and soul and mind with all of our strength. So verses 11, he alone is to be the object of our worship, none other. In verses 8 to 10, he directs the manner of our worship. There's no idolatry. In verse 11, he prescribes the reverence that we're to accord to the worship of his name. That's the first three commands. He demands and claims our worship. And then verses 12 to 15, he claims our work and our rest. We're to live according to the liberating rhythms of our Redeemer himself. Rest, you see, is the blessing of the liberated. There was no Sabbath rest, was there, in Egypt? But you see, work and material gain that comes with work, that can become the object of our worship, can't it? And so God's Sabbath rest keeps his people from becoming slaves to the material and turning work and those rewards of work into our God. And when we come to chapter 15 and 16 that expand and press home the implications of this command, we will see that giving away generously material things is also a key part of what it means to keep the Sabbath. And then verses 16 to 20, we see that he commands and claims in the fifth to the ninth commandments, all our relationships with family, with society, with life itself, with prosperity, property, people's reputations. Again, all of these relationships can be twisted and become false gods, idols to rival our true allegiance to God as our one Lord. But no, he claims all of our relationships for him. And then verse 21, the 10th commandment, he reminds us that he claims above all things our whole hearts, which are the root of idolatry and all unfaithfulness. Covetousness, says Paul, is idolatry because it means setting our hearts, our real affections, our love on something or someone that isn't our true love, the Lord who redeemed us. And so in a way, to break the 10th commandment, to covet, is also to break the first commandment, is to put other gods before the one true God. But no, his grace claims all of us, our love, our desires, our affections, everything. And you see how the Decalogue is so concise, and yet it is so complete in its claim, and so comprehensive. They're almost limitless applications to every possible area of life that we can imagine. So yes, the Lord is in the midst of us here in the congregation. But when our service ends, he doesn't stay behind. He doesn't say, oh, I'll see you next Sunday. No, his demands follow us home. They permeate our diaries, our calendar. They follow us into our public life, into our private life, into our family relations, into our sexual relations, into our business life, into our professional life, our banking life, every part of life, into our small talk, into our testimony about others, whether it's in the courtroom or whether it's on Facebook or wherever. And above all, his demands follow us constantly, claiming our heart. He is the Lord who redeemed Israel out of the house of bondage. And he's the Lord who redeemed us through the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, from the slavery of sin, from the sentence of hell itself. How much more then should his love, so amazing, so divine, as the hymn says, How much should it demand our soul, our life, our all? How much more? Surely we want that to be so, don't we? We know that, as Jesus said, the commandment of the Lord is eternal life. And we say, don't we, with the Apostle Paul, that the commandment is holy, it's righteous, it's good, and we delight in our inner being in the law of God. But also, like him, the more we see of God's righteousness, his holiness here, the more conscious we are of the weakness of our flesh, the more conscious we are of the war still raging with the indwelling sin in our members that we know bedevils us and will bedevil us as long as we have to live in these still fallen bodies and in this still fallen world. And so we find ourselves, don't we, deeply humbled, ashamed, because of just how far short we do fall again and again and again of walking in the truth, of walking in the way of true faith that he has called us to and claims from us. And so we realize that to truly hear the voice and to hear the word and the call of our Redeemer, we need to go on being humbled by the awesome presence of the Redeemer. And that's what happened here at Sinai, and it's what verses 23 to 33 show us. The impact on the people of the revelation that they received. As God's self-revelation of his glory, his majesty, his holiness, in these words spoken and written, as they instilled in that people a humble, a reverent fear for the Lord. And God says, look at verse 29, God says, that's the right reaction. That's the reaction I'm looking for always in response to my word of covenant grace, that my people should fear me and keep my commands. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling is what the psalmist says to us in Psalm 2. That's the eternal gospel. That's the gospel to all the earth through our Lord Jesus Christ that John proclaims in Revelation chapter 14. When he saw the angels proclaiming, fear God and give him glory and worship him who made the earth and the sea and the springs of water. It's only the penitent who bow down. It's only those who cry out, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. It's only those who humble themselves before the holiness of God that Jesus says can be exalted. Only the poor in spirit, who mourn for their sin, who hunger and thirst for a righteousness they need but know they do not have. And that's what these verses show us in the unbearable impact of holiness on sinful people when their ears and their hearts are touched by the word of God in God's gracious revelation of both his great righteousness and therefore our terrible sin in the face of his righteousness. As John Newton's hymn says, it was grace that first taught my heart to fear, and then my fears relieved. And you see, in his grace, God's word, in his commands and his promises of the eternal gospel, they show us, don't they, our urgent need. And God's word make us cry out to him for mercy, to meet the need, as we're humbled to see just how helpless we are. And these verses reveal three great ongoing needs of God's people if they are to be enabled to walk in his truth, in real faith, following his ways all the days of their lives. And the first is that we need a real mediator. That was the people's cry here in verses 24 to 27. God has revealed himself, and who can stand the great fire of his holiness? All flesh, verse 26, all flesh is exposed before him. Why? Well, Paul tells us in Romans 3:20, for through the law comes the knowledge of sin. And the people here cry to Moses to be a mediator, verse 27. That's what they're saying. Stand between us and the holiness of God. You see, to truly understand God's law, his claim upon our lives, it could lead us to abject despair. But the one thing it could never lead us to, if we truly understand it, is to self-effort and self-righteousness. No one at Sinai here ever imagined that they could somehow just try a little bit harder and then impress God with their own righteousness. Absolutely not. They were overwhelmed by the reality of their own sinfulness and God's awesome holiness. But they also knew that this God is their great Savior, their great Redeemer, the God of sovereign grace. And therefore they knew that what God was asking of them and commanding of them was not impossible. To use Moses' own words later on in chapter 30, it is not too hard for you. It's not afar off. It's near you. It's in your mouth and in your heart so that you can do this, what God is asking of you. If you'll do it his way. That is the way of humble trust in the covenant grace that he's revealed to you in these words. And humble obedience to his appointed mediator, not in haughty pride and presumption of your own. And that's what Israel did here, verse 27. They said to Moses, "You go here, go near, hear everything that God will say to you, and tell us, and we will do it." Sinful people need a real mediator. And they need a right mind, as is endorsed by God himself here in verses 28 and 29. That is, they need the humble obedience of real faith. You see, it's the attitude of our hearts and our minds that always governs our response to God's commands and tells whether it's real heart obedience out of love and reverence for the Lord the Savior, or whether it's just religious law keeping. It's all about love for ourselves and for our own reputation. The one, you see, speaks of a real living relationship with God by faith. The other just speaks of the dead religion of works. It's all about whether your mind, whether your heart is right, whether it's been touched by God's word so that you've been humbled by his grace to submit to him, his way, as the people did do here. But alas, not forever. And as Paul explains to us, sharing indeed the passionate longing that God himself shows here in verse 29, Israel in the main did not go on pursuing God's instruction of righteousness by faith. But he tells us in Romans chapter 9, they did so as if it were by works. That is, they were seeking to establish their own righteousness. They did not submit to God's righteousness in Moses' words and the prophet's words later, nor ultimately in the Lord Jesus Christ himself. They rejected him. Why? How could such a thing happen? Well, we know what happened. We've read the rest of the Old Testament. We know what happened all through Israel's history. By and by, they began to forget the awesome holiness of God. They began to forget what a fearful thing it was to be exposed by God's command. They neglected God's word. And the Bible became a lost book. It became a dusty relic. Its message was just vaguely remembered. All the religion carried on, all the sacrifices, all that sort of thing. But the reality about the real terrible seriousness of sin, about the real and terrible holiness of God, became muted as people neglected God's word. And so people began to think that, well, they're okay, really. Some probably thought because they were far superior to many that God would look on them with favor. Indeed, God owed it to them to be impressed with their righteousness. Others, no doubt, thought they had great pride in their spiritual pedigree. Once an Israelite, always an Israelite. That's what they loved to say. They probably congratulated themselves that they at least could recite the 10 points of Judaism or the Horeb confession of faith. You see, they were no longer humbled by the awesome presence of the Redeemer, no longer humbled by God's grace, but rather hardened by their own spiritual pride and presumption. And friends, that's something the New Testament warns us about repeatedly. We need to beware lest any of us be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. Spiritual conceit is a very dangerous thing. Evangelical conceit, a very dangerous thing. We need a right mind and a right heart to keep leading us to our real mediator, the Lord Jesus Christ, through whom alone and whose mercy alone we can approach God. And if we're to have that, we need also what God gave to his people here through Moses, and that is a recurring ministry, a teaching ministry that Moses had to go on expounding and applying the whole counsel of God to the whole people of God. Look at verse 31. "You stand here by me," said the Lord, "and I will teach you, Moses, the whole commandment." That is the whole covenant revelation, the whole counsel of God, and all its application in terms of statutes and rules for life as my people in my land. And you will teach it to them that they may live and go on living. You see, he's saying that's how the God whose living word has such impact today, that's how it will go on having impact tomorrow and the next day and all down the years, all the days of your lives. That's how God's word will keep arresting and humbling his people, so that they do have a right mind and right heart, so they do keep on having access to him through the mediator, so they do keep walking in the one way of life. That's how they'll keep hearing their Redeemer and his abiding voice and keep heeding his authoritative words and go on being humbled by his awesome presence, so that they can go on walking in the truth in the way the Lord has commanded, and so that they will know the life that is abundant life, only if they have that recurring ministry of the whole counsel of God, so that they don't forget him and his greatness and his glory and his holiness, and don't forget their own sinfulness, and don't become hardened to his grace instead of humbled by his grace in his word. And Paul the Apostle knew that, didn't he? He tells us in Acts chapter 20 about his whole teaching ministry in Ephesus and says, "I never stopped teaching you the whole counsel of God." And he says to the leaders who will lead after he's gone, "Go on doing as I've done, because there will be dangers and snares and fierce wolves. And it is only," he says, "the word of his grace which is able to go on building you up and giving you an inheritance among the saints." They needed a recurring ministry of the whole counsel of God. And so do we. How much greater is the privilege that you and I have, to whom God has spoken not only through his servant Moses, but through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and has revealed to us in the cross at Calvary both the terrible, terrible, just anger at sin, but also the wonder of his redeeming love and mercy towards sinners. A message that humbles every one of us utterly and completely beneath the sheer weight of his grace. How much more do we need to keep hearing that message that so humbles us and keeps us in the faith? Therefore, says the apostle, we must pay much closer attention to what we have heard, lest we drift from it. For how shall we escape if we neglect such a great salvation? Take care and exhort one another every day, as long as it is called today, that none of you be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. For we share in Christ if we hold our original confidence to the end. But friends, we will go on walking in the truth till the end if we help one another every day, as long as it is called today, to go on hearing the Redeemer's abiding voice and heeding his authoritative words, and so being humbled by his awesome presence. We will walk in the truth till the end that way. Amen. Let's pray. Almighty and everlasting God, give us, we pray, the increase of faith and hope and love, and that we may obtain what thou dost promise. Make us to love that which thou dost command, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We're going to sing as we close the prayer of the psalmist in Psalm 119, which you'll find at number 119F in our blue books. Teach me, O Lord, your way of truth, and from it I will not depart, that I may steadfastly obey. Give me an understanding heart. In your commandments make me walk, for in your law my joy shall be. Number 119F. How thankful we are for that grace shown so marvelously to us in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.